Well, about a week or so ago, at a NASA press conference, the investigators in charge of the Parker Solar Probe described their new findings from the first flybys of that probe. Now, as far as I have been able to find out, the probe has made about three closer and closer passages to the sun, and it will continue to do that for several years. And hopefully, if it doesn't burn up, it'll continue to do that. But in any event, the NASA press conference included the statement, which is sort of typical of them, quote, "This is the first time we've been able to fly a spacecraft into the atmosphere of a star." They said that last time too, and I commented that on that kind of statement. It all depends on what you call the atmosphere of a star. What is the sun's atmosphere? Well, the sun's local plasma extends out to the extent of the heliosphere, which ends in what we call the heliopause, and that's several times the distance out of Pluto. So by definition, any probe or satellite that gets out of Earth's atmosphere is in the sun's atmosphere, if you realize the sun's atmosphere goes out that far. But actually, the proper question is, how close to the sun's photospheric surface will the Parker probe get? Will it get into the sun's corona? Will it get below the corona? Oh, no, certainly not. It will not get below the corona. Nothing's going to, in the foreseeable future, will ever get through that kind of temperature. But NASA says that the probe will, in 2025, get within a distance of 4 million miles. Okay, I think, as I said last time, that 4 million miles is about 9 solar radii. That is, if you take a picture of the sun during a full solar eclipse and see the corona there, if you look and scale the distance, let's say, from the center of the sun to the edge of the black dot, the shadow of the moon in front of the sun, that's, of course, the solar radius. And so if you measure out 10 times that distance, that's where closest approach of the Parker probe will get. It used to be said that the farthest out that the corona extends is about 5 solar radii. So I said last time, and I still think it, that the Parker probe was not going to get even close to the outermost regions of the corona. But recently, NASA says, no, the corona extends out to something like 5 million miles, 12 solar radii. And so it may get in, depending on when, I guess, the feelings of the sun at the moment, how far it extends its corona, it may touch the outer reaches of the corona. But they're assuming it's going to. The press release goes on to say that the present data that they're getting back, quote, hints at the likely birthplace of dynamic solar winds, which bathe our entire solar system in energy. And that's certainly true. They continue, they say, it describes startling reversals, that is to say, switchbacks in the sun's magnetic fields. And it detects dust in the solar wind, and it shows that solar winds spin. And they say, of course, in their airy, frivolous language, it spins like children riding on a playground carousel. Anyway, if you can get through that, whenever you hear about things spinning, just quietly think about the fact that force-free currents are collections of counter-rotating, spinning magnetic field and current pathways. I submit, and I have submitted for a long while, that they're about the only natural phenomenon that do consist of concentric counter-rotating cylinders that do indeed spin, or at least a twist. In one of our last space news segments, we discussed reports that the Voyager probes have observed unexpected rotation of the magnetic field through which it is traveling. That is, the Voyagers. They're out at the other end of the thing. They're out at the heliopause. And my comment at that time says that, wow, that's fantastic, because that would fit like a hand into a glove with our Juergens electric sun model. And that would say that, yes, they have left the heliopause, the heliosphere, out through the heliopause, but it still hasn't left the giant Birkeland current that feeds this whole solar system and feeds our sun. Still seeing the rotating magnetic fields within that Birkeland current. Back to the present, though, the present report, I feel it's very likely that the pointed tops of the so-called coronal caps, regions where the rays of plasma that are leaving up through the corona, instead of diverging from a central point, i.e. the sun, they, after they leave, they seem to, at certain places at least, come back together again and form a triangular or at least a conical kind of a cap. But anyway, a longtime EU member, good friend of ours, Chris Reeve, apparently asked the question, isn't it possible that these switchbacks are simply the probe moving through the counterflowing Birkeland current cylinders of each filament? And I, when I saw that, I said, hurrah, thank you, Chris. Yes, it absolutely is, of course, yes. It's quite likely that the coronal caps, those pointed hat shapes we observe in the outer regions of the corona, are exactly where Birkeland currents form. And those Birkeland currents extend out to places like the north poles of the planets. So Birkeland currents would explain the spinning and the reversal of direction of magnetic fields that the Parker Solar Probe observes and that the investigators have found so typically surprising. Why are there all sorts of different elements, you know, manganese, calcium, iron, sulfur, oxygen, you name it, all the other elements in addition to the hydrogen and helium that their model says has to be there, but their model of nuclear fusion does not produce manganese, calcium, oxygen, sulfur, and all the raft of other elements. And so where does it come from? In deeper outer cosmic space, there are novae explosions, suns explode, and they pepper the universe with, and Scott adds parenthetically, fairy dust that sprinkles throughout the galaxies and intergalactic space. And that's how all these other kinds of elements that the sun doesn't generate, that's how they get on the sun. It's like a snowstorm, and they come in from out deeper outer space. Now, if you believe that, I got a bridge that connects Manhattan and Brooklyn. I would be very willing to sell you. Alfian and all the earlier plasma physicists were well aware that most plasmas are what are called dusty plasmas. And that means that they contain neutrals. A fully ionized plasma is very rare. They say that the outer regions of the coronas are corona of our sun and probably other stars, are fully ionized plasma. But 99% of most plasmas are not fully ionized. In fact, Hannes Alfian was quoted as saying, if the plasma was more than 10% ionized, it could be considered a fully ionized plasma because the forces between the ions and electrons that were there are so much stronger than the gravitation between the neutrals that the neutrals, the gravitational effects just don't count. So that's a long-winded way of saying, sure, plasmas are dusty. That's where the dust comes from. It comes from within the sun as the ions and the electrons come blasting out of the sun. They bring neutrals with them. And that's where it came from. I don't think you have to depend on asteroids melting in the near the sun to explain that. In describing the switchbacks or magnetic reversals the Parker probe has seen, the press release stated, quote, these reversals happen at a high rate of occurrence. That high rate is surprising. In fact, the nature of these structures remains unknown. Well, we can help them with that, I think. But anyway, we know that the Parker probe is traveling at a speed of approximately 430,000 miles an hour. Now, that's fast. It's, in fact, it's 190 kilometers per second. And so in a couple of minutes, the probe travels about 15,000 kilometers. So that distance could very well be the thickness of one of the layers in the Birkeland current, which would be the cause of those magnetic reversals as it goes through the Birkeland current. The press release also announced that close to the sun, the solar wind seems to get sped up by powerful rogue waves, quote-unquote, that move through the magnetic field. The quote from the press release states, quote, we'd suddenly see a spike in the flow where in just a couple of seconds, the solar wind would start flowing at 300,000 miles an hour faster. That's about 134 kilometers per second increase in the speed of the solar wind that they're observing. And if the velocity of the wind is about 400 kilometers a second, the press release said they were doubling the speed. It's not quite doubling. Also, they quote, they said, there are jets of plasma in these streamers. Well, I maintain that the increases in the solar wind speed may indeed be caused by double layers. Now, in the past, our viewers have seen this image that I've included here of what a double layer looks like. So just to refresh the viewer, there are three plots there. The top graph is the voltage that we would measure as a function of radius distance out from the sun. So you can see that the voltage is dropping rather precipitously from point C to D to E. And that results in the middle plot, which is the electric field that is produced by that sharp drop in voltage. Now, there's nothing mysterious about that electric field. It's just the force on a positive ion. And if the electric field is positive, as you see it, there it is, that means that the force on that positive ion is outward in the positive direction. Outward is from the sun is the positive direction. So the bottom plot there is the plot of the charge distribution that would be there to cause what those other two plots look like. That's from Maxwell's equations. But if we look at the charge distribution there, you can see that there are two spherical shells, one of positive ions, and then right on top of that, a shell of negative charges, mostly probably electrons. And that's why it's called a double layer. The plus and the minus layer are right there together. And there are two different spherical shells in that double layer. The inner half, the inner one, is positive, and the outer half is negative. And in between, in the center of that double layer, is an extremely strong electric field. Now, that electric field, if it's strong enough, can actually rip apart any charged intruder into the double layer. So the sapphire experiment that everybody has been hearing about, and it's worked out so well for us, that experiment produced an image of a whole series of these double layers surrounding the anode, the sun. And the most powerful one is right there above on the surface of the anode. And that's completely consistent with Juergens' electric sun model, because that's the photosphere. That's where the sunspots all happen, and in that double layer, all sorts of things occur. And then as you go out from that layer, outward from the sun, the double layers get dimmer and weaker. You can see them finally disappear off in the distance. And we don't see any of those double layers around the sun with our eyes or with telescopes now, simply because they're in the dark mode of plasma operation. They're in the same mode of plasma operation that surrounds the North Pole of the Earth. And it's the dark mode. We don't see that either, unless, of course, there's an aurora, and at which time the plasma jumps into the glow mode, and as it did in that photograph that Monty so kindly sent us. But normally it's not visible. It's a dark mode plasma, and so are those double layers around the sun. Also, and things are happening very quickly these days, in a new paper entitled Probing the Energetic Particle Environment Near the Sun, the authors seem to acknowledge that magnetic reconnection can't actually explain some of the effects they're observing. I was waiting, predicting that we would hear about magnetic reconnection, but I'm very pleased that they have essentially written that off, at least in this paper. And they said instead, we find a variety of energetic particle events accelerated both locally and remotely, including by co-rotating interaction regions and impulsive events driven by acceleration near the sun and an event related to a coronal mass ejection, unquote. But so they used the word co-rotating, and I wonder if by using the word co-rotating, did they actually mean counter-rotating? Nothing more was said, and so we'll have to wait to see what they have discovered. But they've discovered everything that they have discovered is certainly explainable by Birkeland currents. Also, incidentally, regarding the question of how all those other elements get onto the face of the sun that we discussed earlier, one of the most important results of the Sapphire team was their discovery that in their electrical plasma discharge, and remember that was in a hydrogen atmosphere, just like the sun is hydrogen, the transmutation of elements occurs. That's the kind of process that the old prehistoric alchemists were looking. They wanted to change lead into gold or something like that. Sapphire has done it in microscopic amounts, but they've done it. so that in a plasma discharge, hydrogen apparently can give birth to a long list of other elements, not just one other, that were not there before the discharge started. So that may well be how those other elements got onto the sun and get onto the sun as we speak. And the point is, fairy dust has nothing to do with it.